Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is social justice. I'd remind members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question, and also that questions 2 and 3 are grouped together, so I'll take any supplementaries after both substantive questions have been asked. A lot of interest in supplementaries, so brief questions and responses, please. And I call question number 1, Kevin Stewart.
What impact it anticipates that the recent UK government budget will have on its aim to deliver social justice?
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann Somerville.
The Chancellor's budget was a missed opportunity to shift the dial on tackling poverty. Decisions to freeze local housing allowance rates and proceed with cuts to the winter fuel payment will increase financial insecurity among thousands of households. Meanwhile, retaining the two-child limit and the rate clause, the benefit cap and the bedroom tax will leave hundreds of thousands of children across the UK facing poverty and hardship. It is also concerning that the UK government will continue the previous government's welfare reforms targeting disabled people. As the Joseph Rowntree Foundation said, ultimately it will take investment in our social security system to seriously bring down hardship.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK budget has failed to scrap Tory austerity measures that we know are drivers of poverty. Policies like the benefit cap, the bedroom tax, the two-child limit and a freeze to local housing allowance rates. Will the Cabinet Secretary call on UK government counterparts to reverse these punitive policies? And will she continue to use the limited powers of devolution to mitigate, where possible, the worst effects of Westminster austerity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Kevin Stewart is quite right, Presiding Officer, to point out about the disappointment within the budget. This government will continue to push the UK Labour government to deliver a social security system that's fit for purpose and to deliver progress towards an essentials guarantee. Until then, now that the budget has passed, the two-child cap is now the Labour two-child cap and the benefit cap is now the Labour benefit cap. It is also disappointing to see the freeze to local housing allowance, given that is one of the main drivers of homelessness, and we need to prevent homelessness as much as we can. As Kevin Stewart says, this government does do a lot to try and mitigate against the worst excesses of the UK governments, both Tory and Labour. We spent about £1.2 billion mitigating the impacts over 14 years. That's £134 million this year alone on discretionary housing payments and the Scottish Welfare Fund, not to mention nearly £500 million on the Scottish Child Payment. We will continue to protect people on low income.
Question 2, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its work regarding social isolation and loneliness strategy, particularly in relation to rural areas ahead of the winter months.
Mr Coke-Upstewart.
Thank you. To support the delivery of our Social Isolation and Loneliness Delivery Plan, we implemented the Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund in March 2023. 53 projects are currently operational across Scotland, delivering projects within communities that provide opportunities for people to connect. At the end of year one, projects reached 11,293 individuals, with a focus on priority groups most at risk of social isolation and loneliness. We know social isolation impacts on mental health, and that is why we continue to support the National Rural Mental Health Forum to build the confidence of rural organisations to deliver mental health support to their members and networks.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for that response. Loneliness affects about 1 in 8 people over the age of 65, and Dumfries and Galloway has one of the highest proportions of older people in Scotland, with about 33,000 people within this age bracket. And I understand what the Minister is saying about mental health. So it means that we've got about 4,000 older people in the region that are struggling with the negative feelings that result from feeling lonely. Added to this in D&G is rurality. Can the Minister comment on whether it's a Connected Scotland policy is likely to be updated with a specific focus on rurality?
Minister.
10 out of the 53 projects of the Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund are based in rural locations. Befriending Network Scotland also receives £40,000 per year for 3 years from the Scottish Government. Approximately one in four of their 118 Scottish members are independent community organisations operating in rural areas. A Fairer Scotland for Older People framework for action was published in 2019. This framework has successfully delivered a range of policy measures, including reducing social isolation. The Scottish Government is now undertaking a refresh of the strategy, which includes the roundtable in Dumfries to hear from older people as part of the refresh of the framework.
Thank you. Question three, Alec Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it's taken to address social isolation and loneliness.
Minister.
The Scottish Government published our delivery plan for our social isolation and loneliness strategy, Recovering Our Connections, in March 2023. The plan aims to better understand social isolation and loneliness, to reduce the harm caused by it and tackle this public health issue. There are a number of actions within it, including funding to support 53 organisations across Scotland, delivering community-led activity that responds to local needs. The Scottish Government will continue to work with the Social Isolation and Loneliness Advisory Group to help us deliver this plan and collaborate on ways to tackle loneliness for those most impacted.
Alec Rowley.
Thank you, Minister. And I've certainly read this strategy that you've highlighted, and it is important work. Recently, I've visited many local organisations and community organisations, Lochelly Lunches, Grow S5, Kinross Day Centre, and Kelty, my home village, the Wee Cafe. All these organisations and many more do an amazing amount of work. They are community-based. So whilst the strategy is welcome, do you accept that it is actually at community level that we can make the difference? And would you have a look at the impact of council cuts on many local organisations who are key to making this strategy work?
Through the Chair, but Minister.
Thank you. The member raises some very important points, and I am well aware of the value that is added by local groups. Of course, Fife Council is Labour-led, and I would ask all councils to consider what Alex Rowley is raising. I would like to highlight the work of Befriending Network Scotland, which I mentioned earlier, receiving £40,000 per year for 3 years, so that covers from 2023 to 2026, and I have visited some of those projects myself. It supports befriending services across Scotland. There are currently 118 Scottish members. Approximately one in four members are independent community organisations operating in many areas, including, well, the one in four is in rural. So several national organisations will serve rural communities through telephone befriending or commission services.
Thank you. I've got a couple of supplementaries. They will need to be brief, but the responses will need to be brief too. Tim Eagle, firstly.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Quickly draw attention to my register of interest. Winter is often a particularly tough time for farmers, especially this year after a difficult harvest. We've got wonderful charities such as the Royal Scottish Agricultural Benevolent Institution, which does amazing work for emotional, practical and financial support. Is there any more the Cabinet Secretary Minister could do to ensure that people know this sort of help is available?
Minister, as briefly as possible.
Thank you. Thank you for Tim Eagle to raising the amazing work that they do. The Scottish Government are committed to continuing to support the Royal Scottish Agricultural Benevolent Institution to provide emotional, practical and financial assistance to people living and working in Scottish agriculture. We grant funded a total of £50,000 to support them in the financial year 2023-24. Taking the total Scottish Government support to £565,000. We are in discussion with RSABI on future funding requirements, and this funding supports them to deliver important services such as emotional, practical and financial assistance to those in the agricultural sector.
Thank you. And briefly, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In its delivery plan for social isolation and loneliness strategy, the Scottish Government commits to tackling the digital divide. And we know that in rural and island areas, especially, older people rely on these communications infrastructures to keep connected with family, friends and care services. With telecom companies planning to end the use of traditional copper network landlines and move to broadband-based phones, what work is the Scottish Government undertaking to ensure that rural areas with hotspots, poor broadband connectivity and emergency alarms reliant on landlines are smoothly transitioned for older people who are more likely to have traditional landlines over a mobile phone?
Before I call you, Minister, I am going to have briefer questions and briefer responses, or we're not going to get through the questions on the order paper. Minister, as briefly as possible.
Presiding Officer, a brief response. Beatrice Wishes raises many issues there that are important, and they cover portfolio colleagues' areas as well, so I will connect with them and issue a more detailed response.
Thank you. Question 4, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports the third sector. Should I start again? Could you hear me? I'll start again. Please. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports the third sector to ensure that learning can be shared and successful local models can be rolled out nationally.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government provides £11.6 million funding to national infrastructure bodies such as the SCVO, OCOSFO and Volunteer Scotland, as well as dedicated local support through the 32 third sector interfaces in each local authority. They all provide learning and sharing opportunities for the wider third sector through networks, events and training and information sharing, enabling organisations to share ideas, best practice and collaborate. The Scottish Government also supports a wide variety of shared learning platforms across all portfolios and has a facilitative role in many of these.
Evelyn Tweed.
Stirling Community Enterprises Resilient Futures project tackles antisocial behaviour and is proving very successful. To ask the Government what steps it can take to support projects and models such as this to be rolled out in other places that may benefit.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Evelyn Tweed for that question and for highlighting the important work of this project. I'm aware that the Minister for Victims and Community Safety visited the project in April this year. And it is very important that we do learn from the success of projects like this so others can learn from best practice in considering adopting it. We look forward to the report and recommendations from the Independent Working Group on Antisocial Behaviour, which is undertaking a review of antisocial behaviour for a more strategic approach, focusing on preventing antisocial behaviour and supporting people. So I would thank Evelyn Tweed once again for raising the awareness of such an important project in her constituency.
Thank you. Supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I recently attended a physical activity class run by Killie Heartmates in conjunction with the Cardiology Rehabilitation Unit in Crosshouse Hospital and noticed the impact on the quality of life and preventing a recurrence of heart and stroke. Does the Minister agree with me that rolling out this kind of collaborative third sector initiative is exactly what the Scottish Government should be helping to expand?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Member again once raises another example of the fantastic work that goes on in our third sector and community groups right across the country. And we are very keen to try and ensure, whether it's through national government funding, local government funding, or indeed funding from trusts and foundations, that we continue to share the best practice, what works, and the impact it's making on the lives of communities throughout Scotland. So again, thank you to the Member for raising yet another excellent example of what can happen.
Thank you. Question 5, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it is doing to support people seeking asylum in Scotland.
Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you. The Scottish Government continues to deliver a range of interventions to support people seeking asylum living in Scotland. Working with partners, we have reaffirmed our approach to support integration from day one in the third new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy and Delivery Plan. Many of the essential services which support people seeking asylum are devolved, and these are delivered inclusively for everyone living in Scotland as far as possible within UK immigration legislation and rules. We are providing £3.6 million of grant funding to Scottish Refugee Council this year for a comprehensive nationwide refugee support service.
Paul Sweeney.
there was dismay and frustration when the government abruptly abandoned their commitment to provide free bus travel for people seeking asylum just a few months ago, with asylum organisations and MSPs on a cross-party basis campaigning on this for 3 years now. I was pleased to hear the government reaffirm their commitment to implement free bus travel for asylum seekers in the chamber just last month, but now we need clearer actions. So will the Cabinet Secretary confirm that this policy will be delivered by the end of the Parliament? And if so, will she set out a clear timeline of next steps, including which implementation options are being considered?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is estimated that a third of people seeking asylum living in Scotland may already be eligible for free bus travel through the National Concessionary Travel Scheme on the basis of age or disability, because these schemes are delivered inclusively. We are committed to exploring if we can extend free bus travel to all people seeking asylum before the end of the current parliamentary session, subject to future successful passage of a Scottish budget containing this issue and an agreed way forward in terms of practical delivery. And I call on Paul Sweeney to urge his benches to be supportive of that budget in order for this to take place.
Brief supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
People seeking asylum are facing impossible choices every single day. I know the Minister knows that. And the bus pass would be a very small but important freedom. But can I ask the Minister, how will she build confidence with this community that this is actually going to happen now? Because for the last 3 years, we've had a cycle of hope and then promise coming from government and then a commitment, only for it then to be dropped. And this community, as she knows, is desperate. They have no faith, no faith this is going to happen. How will the Minister restore faith?
Minister.
I understand Mark Ruskell's frustration, and I am on record, I have shared that. This is not a position that the government wanted to be under very, very challenging fiscal climate that we have had. We have had to make incredibly difficult decisions to deliver a balanced and sustainable spending plans for 2024-25 financial year. At that time, it was unaffordable to progress the piloting of free bus travel for all people seeking asylum in Scotland, and I took that responsibility by making that announcement myself in person. And I would refer the member to my previous answer regarding the forthcoming budget.
Thank you. Question number 6 from Hamza Youssef, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of its Ministerial Population Task Force.
Minister Kilcabstewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The task force met on the 25th of September and discussed delivery of the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan's new place-based interventions, with 6 local authorities receiving a total funding of over £420,000 to support sustainable communities. Members also agreed the next National Islands Plan should include an overarching strategic focus on supporting our island populations. The task force also agreed on evaluation approach for Scotland's migration service. This will support employers and inward investors to use immigration system effectively to meet their needs and assist individuals to relocate to and settle in Scotland. The minutes for these meetings will be published in due course.
Hamza Youssef.
Can I thank the Minister for her comprehensive response? Studies, of course, do show that immigration over the decades has been good for both Scotland and the UK. Extreme anti-migrant rhetoric that seeks to divide our communities was once the exclusive territory of the far right. It's now being adopted, we know, by mainstream political parties in the UK. Does the Minister agree with me that instead of becoming insular as a country, immigration is vital for our nation's prosperity? And does she further agree with me that the best thing that all politicians can do is confront the far right rather than appease them by adopting their rhetoric?
Minister.
Thank you. Thank you to Mr Youssef for making the case for immigration very successfully. Scotland is an outward-looking and welcoming nation, and we can be proud of being such a welcoming country. We celebrate, value and protect diversity in our communities. We all have a responsibility to confront hatred and prejudice wherever and whenever it appears. Scotland is a diverse, multicultural society, and this diversity strengthens us as a nation, and delivery of our new Scots strategy is a crucial way to help us build inclusive and cohesive communities.
Okay, a brief supplementary, Ben McPherson.
Can the Minister update Parliament on the work that the task force is undertaking on the challenges of increasing populations in the east of Scotland, including in my constituency of Edinburgh, Northern and Leith, and if and how and when in time public spending allocations will be adjusted accordingly to meet these rapidly growing demands?
And Minister, as briefly as possible.
Thank you. The task force includes membership across multiple government portfolios, recognising the crucial relationship between population, public services and communities. And we continue to work closely with local authorities and COSLA. I recognise the importance of engaging with and supporting areas experiencing population growth, such as Edinburgh and the Lothians. COSLA are members of the Population Programme Board and jointly chair with the Scottish Government a local government population roundtable. Additionally, COSLA is taking forward a discrete piece of work with local authorities to better understand specific challenges around population growth. The Population Programme will consider the outputs of this work in due course.
Thank you. Question 7, Rose McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to end homelessness.
Minister Paul McLennan.
We are making over £14 million available to councils in 24-25 to deliver a range of services, including homelessness services, topped up by our multi-year £100 million Ending Homelessness Together Fund. We are also introducing new homelessness prevention duties. The UK Government decision to freeze local housing allowance is disappointing. The Joseph Rowntree Foundation said private renters will feel let down by this choice. We are also investing over £90 million in discretionary housing payments to helping families meet their housing costs. On Thursday, we announced further rent control measures to protect tenants and keep people in their homes.
Rose McCall.
I thank the Minister for that response, but quite frankly, the current action is not working. Figures released just last month revealed that over 15,000 children are homeless in Scotland, with the average time to access support worsening. It's just a fact that the Scottish Government has failed to tackle homelessness over the last 17 years. So does the Minister agree with Shelter Scotland that these figures are shocking and indefensible?
Minister.
I want to bring the member back to obviously her party's involvement in this in the last 17 years that she mentions around about the austerity. And I also mentioned about the local housing allowance. That was frozen by her party over a period of years. Now, on top of the figures that I mentioned, we've had an additional £40 million investment in affordable housing this year for voids and acquisitions, which takes our overall investment to over £600 million. And we're also providing an extra £2 million to local authorities with the most significant pressures in temporary accommodation. We're also supporting councils targeting plans to address their local challenges. Now, if she wants to continue the investment that I mentioned there, hopefully she'll vote for the Scottish Government budget, which will come forward in the next few weeks.
Supplementary, Ash Regan.
To ask the Scottish Government what action is being taken to address the impact of the housing crisis on women and children, given the joint report by Shelter Scotland and Engender last month, which highlighted that women are disproportionately affected by the housing crisis and they face unique challenges in accessing safe and affordable housing and also single-sex temporary accommodation.
Minister.
I think there's a number of issues, and I think it's an important point that the member makes. I think in the prevention duties, domestic abuse protocols is something that's very important, and obviously we've been engaging with local authorities and Women's Aid, for example, on that. The point she makes around about same-sex temporary accommodation is something I raise with local authorities with our meeting, and is an incredibly important issue, and I'm happy to engage with the member further on that point.
Thank you. Question 8 from James Dornan, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the national rollout of the carer support payment.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm delighted to confirm that carer support payment launched nationally on Monday and would urge unpaid carers across Scotland to check eligibility and apply. We have worked extensively with carers and those that represent them to deliver an improved benefit, which is extending support for the first time to many full-time students. We are continuing to transfer the benefits of carers allowance clients in Scotland to carer support payment, and we will make further improvements to support for carers after this case transfer is complete.
James Dornan.
I'm also delighted to see the carer support payment rolled out nationally, but many of my constituents may not be aware that it's wider eligibility than the carer's allowance that replaces. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline who is set to benefit most from the devolution of this important social security payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, since 2018, all carers in Scotland getting carers allowance and now those getting carer support payment have benefited from the extra support of the carers allowance supplement. And we've worked with carers to design carer support payment to work better for them. And as I mentioned in my original answer, that extends their eligibility to many in full-time education who were not able to get the carers allowance under the DWP. I hope that does help to remove further barriers to studies for unpaid carers. We expect that to benefit around 1,500 people. We have also reduced the past presence test compared to carers allowance so some carers can get support sooner. And we are designing communications to help carers find wider support that they may be entitled to. And as I said again in my answer, we are already committed to further improvements once that case transfer is complete.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary from Paul O'Kane, who also joins us remotely.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will join me in welcoming the announcement from the UK Government about the increase in the earnings threshold for carers allowance to £45 a week, which will benefit people elsewhere in the UK by 2029. Of course, that will mean a block grant adjustment to Scotland. And I would be keen to understand what the Cabinet Secretary's intention is for that. Will she be changing regulations in terms of carer support payment in order to increase the earnings threshold to ensure that nobody in Scotland loses out as a result?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is a very important point that Paul O'Kane raises, Presiding Officer, and we are very, very keen to look at the plans from the DWP and the timeframes for them. As I've already alluded to, case transfer is continuing for the duration of this year and into next year. But we do need to look very carefully, particularly once case transfer is complete, about the changes that we can make that may be different to what happens down south. But in this aspect, we are very, very keen to work with the DWP to understand their timeline and therefore to understand the block grant adjustment that will be coming our way to ensure that we are doing all we can to support carers. Just as I've already alluded to, we've already taken that decision through much of what we have done through the Young Carers Grant, through the additional payments. We're keen to make sure that we're working closely with the DWP to understand what is coming and when.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow the front benches to change.